terms of humanitarian assistance needed yesterday. So I think the game plan is that we're going to take the $4.5 billion that was in the disaster package that was unfortunately taken out and mark it up next week as a standalone proposition to get money flowing to the border to deal with the housing conditions and take some stress not only off the agents but the migrants. I think it'd be money well spent. It's $3.3 billion. For humanitarian assistance, increase in the shelter capacity for unaccompanied migrant children, the feeding and care of those in custody, transportation requirements, safe and efficient processing centers, and other needs. $1.1 billion for operation support on the border, which includes personal expenses, voluntary surge requirements, detention beds, transportation, investigatory resources, dealing with human smuggling and trafficking, $187 million. To carry out the needed information technology system upgrades and law enforcement pay adjustments to manage the ongoing surge. So it's my understanding that we'll be marking this up in the Appropriations Committee next week, and that was good news. So today we have Acting Director McAleen. Did I get it right? That's close. Kevin. To tell us about what's going on, and I think we all know what's going on, and we all need to come together to fix it. He can tell you better than I, but the numbers are overwhelming. In fiscal year 2019, from October till now, we've had 600,000 people apprehended at the southern border. And all of 2018 fiscal year, it was 300,000. So we've doubled all of 2018, and we still got months to go. And as you can see from the chart here, there's been 135% increase of apprehensions at the southwest border, 74% increase in unaccompanied minors, 463% increase in family units. That doesn't include everybody. When you include everybody, is 144,278 in May alone. The total in FY19 is 676,315, which is double of what we did in 2018. So somebody needs to ask the question, why? What is happening? What has changed in the last year or so? Here's what's changed. The word is out in Central America. And this is a Central America problem, almost exclusively, that if you make it to America, your chances of staying are pretty darn good if you ask for asylum or bring a minor child with you. Now, this is the Spanish language advertisement. This is how it looks translated in English. How much does it cost to cross the border? In 2016, it was $3,000 to $8,000. In 2017, it's $8,000 to $16,000 walking through the mountains. If you take a boat, it's gone from $10,000 to $20,000. Small plane, $16,000 to $30,000. A vehicle utilizing documents belonging to another person is $20,000 to $25,000. Vehicle utilizing an accomplice immigrant agent is $20,000 to $25,000. So the market shows the demand is increased, the prices are going up, and people are walking through hell to get here, dealing with smugglers in every known fashion. Thank you. So the bottom line is, until we change our laws in two areas, this never stops, and that's the purpose of this hearing. As to what President Trump was able to negotiate with Mexico, I think it will help, but I do not believe it's an adequate substitute for us working together in the Congress with the Trump administration to change the laws that create the MAGNA. And here are the laws that we need to change, and this is the bill that I've introduced, and I hope we can get bipartisan support for it. Right now, if you come to America and you claim asylum, you're entitled to a hearing. That hearing is years away. Contrary to what people tell you, most people do not show up for their hearing. We don't have the bed space to hold people, so we dump them out in the country. If you bring a small child with you, Since we don't want to separate families under Flores' decision, we've got 20 days to process the claim. We don't have bed space to hold all the families, so we turn them loose by the thousands. So what am I trying to do? I'm trying to say, for a period of time here, to have a timeout under the current system, and say that if you're from Central America, you can apply for asylum in the for the United States, but you have to do it in your own country at one of our embassies or consulates, and we'll try to set up a facility in Mexico where you can go over to Mexico to apply for asylum in the United States, but you no longer can do it at our border or in our country. If you change that, I think 90% of this would stop. As to the Flores decision, we're trying to give 100 days to process family units with a small child. Just can't get it done in 20 days. And equally important, we're going to allow sending back unaccompanied minors from Central America as if they came from Mexico or Canada. Since these are non-contiguous countries, we don't have the ability to send unaccompanied minors back, and we'd like to change that. We want 500 new immigration judges because we have a 900,000 person backlog in asylum claims. There has to be a breaking point. We've reached the breaking point at the border. I cannot imagine what it's like to go to work every day where half the people are dedicating their time to dealing with family members, minors, and all that goes with trying to deal with 600,000 people in your custody. Half of our resources are being directed away from border security to dealing with housing people and trying to meet their basic health care needs. The breaking point has long passed at the border. This is not sustainable. It's not fair to those who wear the uniform of the United States at Border Patrol, Health and Human Services, and all the other agencies, and to the NGOs who are helping, God bless you. So I just want to make one quick statement. If you're on the border dealing with this problem, you're one of the most patriotic people in this country. You're not the problem. We're trying to help you, to give you more resources and take the pressure off you, because if we don't, there'll come a point to where we'll have complete, absolute failure to control our border, and we're getting there daily. So this legislation is designed to deal with the crisis. If it got out in Central America, you could no longer apply for asylum in the United States. They would stop coming. This would be a death blow to the smugglers. If it got out in the United States, if you bring a small child with you, no longer is that a guarantee that you can stay in the United States. I am willing to help Central America's economy. I'm willing to help President Trump build a wall. I'm willing to work on DACA. I'm willing to do almost anything and everything to fix this mess, but doing nothing is off the table. So we will be marking up this bill next week, and we're going to hear from the director his view of what this legislation would do to fix the problem, describe in detail the nature of the problem, what happens if we do nothing, and hopefully this body can rally around a couple ideas that we need more money for humanitarian assistance, that we need to change our laws. We need to help people in Central America, but I'd end with this. All the money in the world is not going to fix this problem in Central America as long as you can get to the United States and not be sent back. Life here is always going to be better than life there. Our goal is to improve life there and give people some hope in their own country. But what's odd about this disaster is that people are not trying to avoid being caught. They're looking for the first Border Patrol agent they can find to turn themselves in. A wall will not fix this problem. The only way the wall would fix this problem is to build it in Mexico so they'd never step a foot in the United States. But once you put one foot in the United States and you claim asylum, we have a major dysfunctional system. So with that, I'll turn it over to Senator Feinstein, and I appreciate the director and all under his charge for doing an incredible job in difficult circumstances.
Thanks very much, Mr. Chairman, and thank you for scheduling today's hearing. And Acting Secretary, I'd like to welcome you here. I see a few circles under your eyes, but I guess that comes with the territory, but welcome. In looking at the numbers, going back to 1925 to 2018, there have been 15 years where we have had more than a million intrusions. So it's my understanding that we're on track to remain below the historic levels of apprehensions we saw in the late 90s and 2000s. If I might, Mr. Chairman, I'd like to submit this for the record. Thank you. There have been approximately 600,000 crossings of our southern border so far this year. Border Patrol predicts, I understand, that we'll reach about a million crossings before the end of the fiscal year, just as we have in 15 other years. We have had over a decade where the country has faced these crossings in the past, and so it's not unusual that it would happen again. But there's a different population. Right now, the crisis that's being talked about by the administration is not how many people are crossing the border, but it's really a change in who is coming. This year, so far, over 84,000 families have arrived at the border, fleeing to seek asylum in the United States, whereas previously the country faced border crossings from single adults seeking employment. That's a big change. These vulnerable parents and children have experienced violence, abuse, and poverty in their whole home countries, particularly the Central American countries affected, before they begin the arduous journey north. Last week, I met with John Sanders, the acting commissioner of Customs and Border Protection, who explained that Border Patrol apprehended 144,000 people crossing the border in May, including over 11,000 unaccompanied children. That's 11,000 in 1 month, if you can imagine it. On May 30th, the DHS Inspector General found that Border Patrol facilities are overcrowded. One facility in El Paso, Senator Cornyn, is holding 900 people in a space with a maximum capacity of 125. The IG was concerned that this overcrowding represented, and I quote, an immediate risk to the health and safety, not just of the detainees, but also DHS agents and officers, end quote. Acting Commissioner Sanders told me that children in border facilities, in many facilities, have no cots or beds. Instead, they sleep on floors and benches with Mylar blankets. Often, this can be the case for days and even weeks at a time. Acting Commissioner Sanders also confirmed that only a few weeks ago, babies and toddlers were sleeping outside under a bridge in El Paso, entirely exposed to the elements. We also saw firsthand last week that conditions are deplorable for adults in immigration custody. On Thursday, the DHS Inspect IG issued a report that, quote, observed immediate risks or egregious violations of detention standards, end quote, at ICE holding facilities across the country. The inspectors found facilities with moldy vents and concluded that immigrants received contaminated and rotten food. Specifically, the inspectors found chicken packets open and leaking in a refrigerator in an Essex, New Jersey facility. They found spoiled and unwrapped lunch meat in a facility in Adelanto, California. Ultimately, the IG concluded that immigrants are held in facilities that, and this is a quote, show a disregard for detainee health and safety, end quote. This is unacceptable. Last week, I introduced a bill to uphold the humanitarian standards our laws require and ensure that immigration cases can be heard quickly and efficiently. The Protecting Families and Improving Immigration Procedures Act would do the following: end the practice of separating families at the border and ensure children are not separated from their parents. Ensure that families with children are not forced into prolonged detention in order to remain together. Maintain the protections in FLORUS that require children to be treated humanely, given safe places to stay with adequate food and water. Increase the efficiency of our immigration courts while protecting the basic rights of children by adding 450 staff to our immigration courts. This includes 75 additional judges, 75 law clerks, and 300 total support staff. This is the number given to us by Justice as what they need. It's not a number devised by I or my staff. Conserve resources for all immigration judges by restoring judicial discretion to prioritize their cases as needed. And finally, this bill includes a key component of Senator Hirono's bill, which provides counsel for unaccompanied children. This is important because too often young children, including toddlers, have been forced to represent themselves in immigration court. How and by whom this representation service is provided still needs to be worked out. The legislation addresses the needs of the system in handling the increase in asylum cases while maintaining the basic rights of children. Thanks again to Acting Secretary McAleenan for testifying today. I really hope we can find ways to move forward together. I really strongly feel that whatever we do should be bipartisan. I think for this country to separate children, can you imagine how your 4, 5, or 6-year-old would remember that for the rest of his life or her life and be affected by it? I can. I have 7 grandchildren, and it's a traumatic experience beyond, particularly if you end up under a freeway on a rock with a piece of Mylar. And so I hope, Mr. Chairman, that your side will be willing to sit down with us and see if we can't work out some bill of which we as Americans can really be proud. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Senator Feinstein. Senator Cornyn.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, for holding this hearing. And Secretary McAleenan, thank you for being here and for the great work you and the troops you represent are doing along the border, dealing with the unimaginable set of circumstances. As I was listening to the opening statement of our friend, the ranking member, she talked about how the numbers historically have actually been higher, and so the numbers are down, but acknowledged that the composition of the migrants coming across is different. And it's pretty clear to me that the reason for that, as the chairman has pointed out, is that the individuals charging $10,000, $20,000 a person to smuggle them from Central America across Mexico into the United States have found a way to exploit the vulnerabilities in our laws, in our legal system. And they are literally flooding the zone. It is no surprise to me that the detention facilities and the individuals who staff those are completely overwhelmed. And I believe previously you have testified, Mr. Secretary, that the customs officials that ordinarily are responsible for moving legitimate commerce and traffic across our ports of entry have now been redeployed, trying to take care of these children and these families. And that's resulted in congestion, longer wait times, and actually threatening the supply chain of a lot of the manufacturing that goes on cross-border with Mexico. But even as the New York Times has pointed out recently, On Sunday, they wrote, "It's time for Congress to stop dithering and pass emergency funding to deal with this nightmare." So far, we've seen no willingness on the part of our Democratic colleagues to meet us halfway and to come up with the spending bill that would provide the ability for you and the people that work with you to address this humanitarian crisis. And that's shame on us. It seems to me that the implicit argument is that we really ought not to detain people. We ought to simply wave them through and across the border into the great American interior, and that we ought not to have any control over our borders or our immigration system. We are the most generous country in the world when it comes to legal immigration. We naturalize 1 million people a year, roughly. But what we are seeing now is a result of the chaos and the hardship and the crisis that has manifested because we simply have been unwilling as a U.S. government to deal with the flow of illegal immigration and the money-making machine that this represents for the human smugglers. One of the reasons I'm very pleased that the president was able to negotiate with the Secretary of State and others an agreement with Mexico to step up their game and deal with more of the flow of migrants from Central America across their border is because obviously Congress has failed to act to provide you and officials the tools you need in order to stop this on your own. So the president's had to resort to these diplomatic efforts with Mexico. We'll find out whether the 144,000 that the chairman mentioned that came across the border in May, whether those numbers go down in the coming weeks and months. I hope they do. That will be the best evidence of whether this works or not. But there's absolutely no justification whatsoever for Congress to sit on the sidelines and watch as this crisis continues to unfold. Originally, we were told there is no emergency, there is no crisis at the border, but obviously responsible people like former Secretary of Homeland Security under the Obama administration, Jay Johnson, have said unequivocally, there is a crisis at the border. As you have said previously, President Obama in 2014 called it a humanitarian and security crisis. And it's just getting worse and worse as Congress sits on its hands and does absolutely nothing to give you the tools you need in order to stop this crisis and to address it. And that's shameful. As you know, Mr. Secretary McAleen and Senator, I have introduced legislation alongside of that the chairman has called the Humane Act with my friend and colleague, a Democrat from Laredo, Texas, called the Humane Act. And many of the elements are in common with those in the legislation that the chairman has offered. But I hope we can finally come to grips with this crisis and we can do our job on a bipartisan, bicameral basis and provide you and the men and women you represent the tools they need in order to secure our borders and deal with this humanitarian crisis in a compassionate and lawful way. So far, we have been AWOL, and that's shameful. I hope we'll change.
Senator Durbin.
Thanks, Mr. Chairman. What we have seen at our border is not just bad luck or a one-off phenomenon. It is the predictable result of this administration's chosen path on immigration. Make no mistake, Donald Trump takes pride in being the most anti-immigrant president in modern history. And at the same time, his border security strategy is producing the worst results in our history. Let's look at the highlights. The Muslim travel ban created chaos at airports across the United States and continues to separate thousands of American families. The repeal of DACA threatened 800,000 young immigrants with deportation to countries they barely remember. The termination of temporary protected status endangers another 300,000 immigrants. The disastrous separation of infants, toddlers, and young children from their families at our border finally stopped by the courts. The longest government shutdown in the history of the United States, which paralyzed our immigration courts for 6 weeks. The tragic deaths of 6 children who were apprehended at the border and 24 people in immigration detention. And now public reports of attempted suicides by detainees being held in abject, inhumane conditions. The blocking of all assistance to Northern Triangle countries, El Salvador, Guatemala, and Honduras, and shutting down avenues for legal migration, which has driven more refugees to our border. And a gaping leadership vacuum at the Department of Homeland Security. In less than 2.5 years, there have already been 4 heads of this department. We have before us today an acting secretary who has been on the job for more than 2 months. We cannot face this crisis effectively with a revolving door policy in the leadership of the Department of Homeland Security. In fact, every position at DHS with responsibility for immigration or border security is now being held by a temporary appointee who has not been confirmed by the Senate. The White House has not even submitted nominations for these positions. Despite all of President Trump's tough talk and meanness, our southern border today, by every measurable standard, is much less secure than when he took office. Look at the numbers. In just the last 3 months, more people have been apprehended at the border than in all of fiscal year 2017. We have to acknowledge the obvious. President Trump's immigration and border security policies are certifiable failures. And we have learned we cannot count on his administration to work with this unrational immigration policy. This committee, the Senate Judiciary Committee, must assert its constitutional authority. I'm hopeful because I know this chairman. I've worked with this chairman on bipartisan immigration solutions. We were partners in the Gang of Eight. We wrote a comprehensive immigration bill, which passed the Senate 6 years ago in 2013 by a margin of 68 to 32, a bipartisan bill. Republican Senator Lamar Alexander, who supported our 2013 bill, was right when he recently said, and I quote, "If that bill had become law, most of the problems we're having today, we wouldn't be having." Last year, Chairman Graham and I crafted a bipartisan agreement, including robust border security funding and dozens of provisions to strengthen border security. President Trump rejected it, instead pushed for a hardline plan with the largest reduction in legal immigration in almost a century. The Senate rejected the Trump bill by a bipartisan supermajority. Chairman Graham and I also were the lead sponsors of the DREAM Act, which would address the DACA crisis created by President Trump. However, as I've told the chairman, at this moment, the bill that he brings before the committee is one that I cannot currently support, but want to work with him to see if there is a middle ground. That's why we were sent here. This bill, in and of itself, I don't believe that being proposed by the chairman will solve the crisis at the border, but let it be a starting point. I don't like the fact that this bill would overturn critical humanitarian protections for children, subjecting them to even longer detention and deportation without due process. There is no evidence that this will deter desperate families from fleeing to our border. And the bill before us provides no assurance that children will be humanely treated or that they'll be safe from violence once they are deported. This bill does nothing to address the root causes that are causing migrants to flee their homes in record numbers. Instead, I would ask the chairman to work with Democrats on a bipartisan, smart, effective, and humane answer to this challenge, which would include assistance to stabilize the Northern Triangle, cracking down on the traffickers that are exploiting immigrants, in-country processing and third-country resettlement so that migrants can find safe haven without making that dangerous trek to our border, and eliminating immigration court backlogs so that asylum claims can be processed more quickly. Mr. Chairman, this is indeed a crisis. It is a test of our mettle as members of the United States Senate, but it's also a test of this nation of immigrants. We are writing a record we will have to explain to the next generation. The zero tolerance policy is one of the saddest chapters in modern immigration history. We cannot return to that inhumane approach, that deterrent approach, as some call it, at the expense of our values as a nation. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thanks, Senator Durbin. Would you please rise and raise your right hand? You solemnly swear that the testimony you're about to give this committee is the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, so help you God.
The floor is yours. Thank you, Mr. Chairman, Ranking Member Feinstein, distinguished members of the committee. Appreciate the opportunity to appear before you again today. I think this hearing is timely and important, as legislative solutions are essential to addressing the unprecedented security and humanitarian crisis we're facing on our southern border. It's been over 18 months since the administration asked for the legislative fixes that would have prevented the current crisis, and 40 days since we asked for the emergency funding necessary to manage it. In the last 40 days, 60,000 children have entered into DHS custody, both unaccompanied and as part of family units. Last month, as you noted, Mr. Chairman, we encountered a modern record of 144,000 border crossers, a record day of over 5,800 border crossings in a single 24-hour period, and the largest single group ever apprehended at our border, 1,036 individuals. The funding requested in the emergency supplemental, and thank you for the news on the progress on this bill, would be applied within weeks to provide additional facilities for Health and Human Services to prevent children from having to wait in Border Patrol stations and to improve the care of those in DHS custody, while providing operational support and funding for the men and women of DHS managing the crisis. Without it, DHS will not be able to provide appropriate facilities and care, migrants will remain in custody at the border longer than necessary, and DHS will ultimately need to reprogram funding carefully appropriated by Congress from other critical Homeland Security priorities. The impact of that reprogramming will be significant and affect nearly every component of the department. I want to two weeks ago that I met, talked about his daughter leaving with her child this year, and he said, everybody knows that a child is a passport for migration to the United States. The weaknesses in our laws now represent the most significant factors affecting border security and are allowing the cycle of misery to continue. We are asking for narrow and targeted changes to our laws that will restore integrity of the immigration system and remove the incentives for families and children to cross our border illegally. Currently, due to a single district court order, we cannot obtain effective immigration enforcement results for the families arriving at our border. Instead, they cannot be held longer than 21 days and do not receive rulings from immigration courts for years. The asylum standards are also misaligned, with a significant difference between the number of migrants who meet the initial credible fear bar but do not have a valid asylum claim at the end of court proceedings. These types of changes were recommended by the Homeland Security Advisory Council Task Force, a bipartisan panel led by experts from across the political spectrum. This legislation proposed by Chairman Graham would address these vulnerabilities and end the crisis, and I appreciate the introduction of this important bill. I look forward to continuing to work with the chairman and members of this committee on this legislation, and I look forward to the committee's questions.
Thank you for the job that you're doing. The pull factors, very simply, what are they?
Very simply, it's our inability to get immigration results for families and the guarantee that unaccompanied children, if they come from other than Mexico and Canada, cannot be repatriated, and that our asylum system is so backlogged that if you meet the initial credible fear bar, you'll be released and allowed.
In April of this year, bipartisan said, by far the major pull factor in the current practice is the current practice of releasing with a notice to appear most illegal migrants who bring a child with them. Is that accurate?
Absolutely.
So what we need to do is more time to process claims involving minors.
Yes.
We don't break up families, right?
Correct.
So if we release the minor, then we release the entire family, right?
That is right.
We don't have bed space to hold them for their hearing.
We're not allowed to hold them long enough for their hearing. Okay.
Past 20 days, the minor has to be released. We choose to release the whole family, and we release them into the interior of the United States. Is that correct?
That is.
So Mexico cannot solve this problem by itself.
Right.
As to asylum claims, we have 900,000 back.
In immigration courts, over 350,000 asylum cases.
Okay, 350,000, 900,000 backlog, 350,000 are asylum claims.
Correct.
Tell the country what happens when you get here from Central America and you claim asylum. Very briefly, what happens?
So as a family unit, as you've already noted, Mr. Chairman, you're going to be released because you can't be held more than 20 days. And we have to have due process and a fair hearing. For single adults, you'll be held pending determination of whether you have a fear of return. If you meet that bar, and 87% do meet the initial bar of credible fear from Central America, you'll either be held or bonded out by an immigration judge pending a final adjudication. If you're a child, you'll be transferred to HHS, and you'll go through a process to be placed with a sponsor in the United States.
So if you're a asylum seeker from Central America and you claim asylum in the United States, you're not going to get sent back to Central America anytime soon, is that correct?
Unless you're a single adult, it is very unlikely that you'll be repatriated.
What percentage of the people show up for the asylum hearing?
So it depends on the demographic, the court, but we do see too many cases where people are not showing up. We did an expedited pilot with family units this year with ICE and the immigration courts. Out of those 7,000 cases, 90 received final orders of removal in absentia, 90%.
90% did not show up?
Correct.
Okay.
That is a recent sample from families crossing the border.
So if we changed our laws to say the following, you cannot apply for asylum if you're from Central America in the United States. You must do it in your home country or maybe Mexico if we can get a deal with Mexico. What effect does that have on this problem?
So first of all, it would break the back of the smuggling organizations. They're profiting from this cycle. It would provide access to asylum in country in a much safer manner than taking this dangerous journey, and it would stop this flow immediately.
How much of it would stop, you believe?
I believe the vast majority would stop. But we're looking at about 30% right now of single adults, criminals and smugglers that are trying to evade capture at the border. The other 70%, as you noted, Mr. Chairman, are presenting themselves
to Border Patrol. So if we made those two changes, extend the Flores decision to 100 days so that we'd have time to process these people and not release them into the interior of the country, changed our asylum laws, do you think 90% of this flow from Central America would stop overnight?
I think between 70 and 90% would stop, yes.
Okay. As to the humanitarian assistance we're talking about, is it needed?
Is humanitarian assistance
needed? Yeah, the $4.5 billion. Do you need the money?
The $4.5 billion is essential. $3.3 billion is for health and human services, simply to provide appropriate care for children arriving unaccompanied at our
border. So what percentage of the force now is dealing with the problems of taking care of people versus guarding the border?
So in our key sectors, we're up to 50% on some days. In
so 50% of the force is now dealing with the problem of dealing with migrants, providing them care, food, and clothing, and medical assistance, versus dealing with trafficking and drugs and the other duties you're assigned. Is that correct?
That's correct.
If we do nothing, what will it be like next year?
So this escalating set of crossings, from 60,000 a month for the first 3 months of this year. When I came to this committee in December, I testified about a peak day of 3,029. We had 5,800 cross the last week of May. We've gone from 100,000 to 109,000, 144,000 divorced from the seasonal averages and processes we've seen in the past. I do not know how high it will go in terms of the number of families that are willing to come to the U.S. and want to come to the U.S. for a better opportunity.
But you do know that if we do not change the pull factors, they're going to keep coming.
Yes. Right? This crisis will worsen and deepen.
And the wall has no effect on this. They're wanting to get captured. Is that correct?
Correct. The wall is for the border security problem, the adults trying to evade capture, the smugglers and the criminals.
So these people are looking for the first Border Patrol agent they can find to turn themselves in.
Walking directly up to uniformed agents, yes.
So will President Trump sign my bill if it was passed?
I believe that he's already said in the Rose Garden when he announced a broader package of immigration changes for the Congress to consider that your bill would be directly targeted at the crisis and would help address the flu.
Very quickly, Senator Feinstein has some legislation. Did you follow what she was saying?
I did.
Do you agree that some of those things would be good for you and your agents?
I think additional judges and support staff, it's really critical. We have the attorneys. That's an important piece. I think we could talk about the training for dealing with children.
I think more money wisely spent to Central America may help the underlying cause.
If we have targeted investments with accountable partners, I do think so. And we're doing that right now with our security efforts.
Thank you, Senator Lee.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, Senator Feinstein. It's interesting hearing about and allowing this to become so politicized. After Republicans blocked the money for months that we were trying to put forward to help at the border, and even when we had a bipartisan bill, Republicans took that out a few weeks ago. It's kind of hard to blame Democrats, but we did come together a few years ago when I was chairman of this committee. Republicans and Democrats worked on the immigration bill. Senator Graham was essential in that, Senator Durbin. As Senator Alexander said, had we put it into law, we'd be a lot better off. I would note that even though we passed by an overwhelming bipartisan majority in the Senate, the Republican Speaker of the House said they couldn't bring it up because it would require a bipartisan vote, and that would violate the sacred Dennis Hastert rule. They were so impressed and wanted to honor Dennis Hastert that they wouldn't allow it to come forward. Think about that. Now, we're willing to put the money. We support ensuring the HHS can care for unaccompanied minors. We support ensuring that CBP can safely process migrants seeking refuge. We just want basic standards of humanitarian care. Now, whether a supplemental gets done is up to the administration. If you have, if they continue to block bipartisan legislation, nothing happens. I hope that Republicans will finally realize we have to do this, Republicans and Democrats, together. And not block as it did even a couple weeks ago. We want long-term solutions. Now, President Trump recently cut off nearly $500 million in aid that we approved over 14 months ago, aimed at reducing gang violence, alleviating poverty, improving the rule of law in the Northern Triangle. Both Republicans and Democrats have pointed out this makes a bad situation worse. Now, you've said that the U.S. is formalizing a number of initiatives to limit push factors. Would you agree that it's critical we provide the targeted aid that Congress had previously appropriated in a bipartisan way to address these root causes of migration?
A couple key points. Good to see you, Senator Leahy. I've testified in front of this committee before that I believe that a multi-pronged solution involves working with the governments of Central America on the push factors. The specific piece that you just referenced about anti-gang initiatives, the Attorney General just went to Central America 3 weeks ago, and those programs are restarted. They are going to continue to be funded.
They were blocked for a long time after a bipartisan bill passed them. And we have nonprofits like Catholic Charity. They've stepped in to assist. They're doing extraordinary work.
If I could just add, Senator, the other programs you're referencing, they're frozen, but they're under review to make sure that there's a return on investment, that they're targeted in a way that will actually address the push factors and that we can partner with the Central American governments to be effective.
Basically, they're frozen, even though we had a bipartisan majority pass the money. You're saying no. Interesting.
You want to make sure they work.
We'll never find out, will we? Catholic Charities is helping a lot. What if these nonprofits were no longer able to provide services? Would that hinder you?
So I met with Catholic Charities a week before last in Guatemala, hearing about the work they're doing, their concerns about programs that are frozen, and that's the kind of consideration we'll be looking at with the frozen funding to see what's working and what's appropriate to continue.
Have they been helpful?
I think a number of these programs have been helpful, and we just have to make sure that we're investing in the right ones.
Well, I want to make sure we're doing the right thing, too. Now, I find that ICE has deported many veterans, people who served in the military, served our country in the military. And they have the rules requiring such removal decision be approved by senior officials. They weren't. Now, I understand that President Trump said that everyone's a priority for removal. And he doesn't understand what it's like to serve in the military. He had the ability, because of his position, to avoid the draft 5 times. What about, though, these people have served our country? Many of them have served in very dangerous places. They've helped to protect our country. And ICE is deporting them without being approved by senior officials. Is that wrong?
So I've been briefed on that GAO report result, Senator, and I'm not aware of deportations that weren't approved by the senior official in accordance with the policy. I'll follow up on that.
Well, but the GAO requirement said that, report said that many of these deportations occurred without the required additional screening because ICE was unaware of its policies. But you're saying that they did do the additional screening, they did have higher officials, which would contradict the GAO report. Which one's right?
So I'll follow up on that piece of the question. What I can tell you is that all of those individuals who were deported had felony criminal offenses, some of them very serious, and it was assessed by ICE before they were deported. And it is, I do respect their service. We respect the service of all veterans, but you have to also make sure you're protecting the communities under the immigration laws.
You said almost 4,800 migrants are presented as fraudulent family units this year. Does that include people who have familial relationships other than simple parent-child, such as grandparents or siblings?
So when we're talking about fraudulent presentation, we're talking about individuals who presented an adult-child relationship as a parent or guardian. That's the primary focus there. I'd just like to add that we put 400 HSI investigators down in our key stations in El Paso and RGV. They've only been there for about 5 weeks. They've done about 1,000 interviews to date, 1,568 interviews, and they've identified 242 cases of fraud and 504 fraudulent documents. We also did a DNA pilot for 3 days, only 109 families. 17 cases where the parent or guardian presenting was not related. In fact, 9 of them admitted that they were not related as they came up to the DNA testing. One individual was a 51-year-old who had paid $80 to rent a 6-month-old child to come to the border. We're very concerned about the incidence of fraud. We think it's a huge part of this cycle, and it's caused by the fact that they know if they come as a family, they'll get special treatment at a border.
As am I, and I thank the chairman, and I, as I said when you were nominated, I offered you congratulations and condolences. But frankly, I'm glad you're there. Thank you.
Thank you.
I'm glad you're there, too. Senator Grassley.
Me too.
First of all, Mr. Chairman, I'd like to enter in record, and I'll describe it right here. 4 articles about child smuggling across the border. One particular article by AP referenced a Guatemalan woman charged in South Carolina who said she rented out or recycled children 13 times for smuggling across the border with payment of $1,500 a child.
Without objection.
Mr. Secretary, thank you for being here. I wrote a letter to then Secretary Nielsen about a 13-year-old girl from Guatemala who was seeking entry into the United States. This girl was accompanied by an unrelated adult male who claimed to be her father. His name was Ramon Pedro. Pedro convinced the girl's mother that he would take the girl to America and provide her a job. As a result of the Flores settlement and insufficient bed space, Border Patrol had to release them both after 20 days. Over a month later, both Pedro and the girl were admitted to a hospital in Fresno. At the hospital, doctors discovered the girl had been viciously sexually assaulted by this man while she was in his custody. Police arrested the man for rape and child endangerment. As you know, Mr. Secretary, this happens all too often. So where are we today? Over 600,000 apprehensions so far this year. CBP facilities are beyond crisis level. ICE has been forced to release hundreds of thousands of people into the country without status. HHS facilities of unaccompanied children are beyond capacity. But House of Representatives, controlled by the Democrats, have now proposed in a spending bill that slashes the Department of Homeland Security resources to carry out your mission as assigned to you by this Congress. It seems Washington has all of a sudden lost all common sense. Mr. Secretary, I have limited time, only 3.5 minutes left, so yes or no to these questions. ICE and CBP officials have talked to me about child recycling or trafficking the same children back and forth across our border to help unrelated adults gain entry. Is it true that the Flores and also the TVPRA and other loopholes have incentivized child smuggling and child recycling?
Yes.
Will DNA testing allow DHS to determine which family units are fake and in doing so protect the safety and health of minor migrant children?
Yes, we believe it'll help.
This winter, Congress underfunded your department, limited ICE enforcement abilities, and cut detention space. Did these cuts help the department, the American people, or the migrants?
No.
Did these cuts make the problem at our border worse?
Yes.
Does recycling interagency information sharing, or no, by restricting interagency information sharing about potential sponsors for unaccompanied children, make unaccompanied children safer?
No.
Senator Blackburn, Hawley, and Cotton, and I have a bill that requires information sharing between DHHS and DHS. Would this improve the government's ability to provide a safe and secure home for our unaccompanied children?
Yes, I believe it will, and Senator Cornyn's bill has a similar provision.
Yeah. Now, in a few minutes I have left, it's kind of outrageous to me that we hear all this talk about humanitarian crisis at the border, that it may be manufactured by the President of the United States, and yet we have these obvious mistreatment of children, recycling of children, being paid to do it, probably the cartel benefiting from it. And there doesn't seem to be the outrage that there ought to be, particularly in the media of the United States, that is the police force for our democratic system of government, that they aren't paying any attention to it, always finding something wrong that the president's doing. It's just outrageous. And it's outrageous that we can't pass legislation to correct this. And somehow, you know, passing a little piece of legislation stopping recycling, as an example, that wouldn't be so important that you wouldn't worry about having a bipartisan agreement to get a bill passed. I yield back the balance of my time.
Senator Feinstein.
Mr. McAleen, June 26 will be the one-year anniversary of the court order requiring reunification of families who are separated under the Trump zero tolerance policy last year. How many children, Mr. McLean, have been separated from their parents since June 26th of last year?
So, and thank you, because it's actually June 20th, the President's executive order that ended it. June 26th was the court order in Ms. L., and we've been complying with both directions, both the President's and the court order, ever since. It's been a year, almost. During that time, about 0.36 of those families crossing have been separated.
They've been separated. Can you give me a number of children separated?
I can.
0.36 doesn't do it.
We can do the math for you, Senator, but we're talking about between 1 and 5 families a day, when we've seen, obviously, in the last year, 1,500 to 3,500 families crossing on average. So it's a very rare circumstance. It happens only for the safety and welfare of the child, where we have a concern about abuse or neglect, where there's a communicable disease, an emergency medical issue, or a serious criminal prosecution unrelated to the unlawful border crossing.
I just want
those are the standards.
A hard number.
Be happy to get that for
which
you.
Which I can't find anywhere, of how many children have been separated since June 26.
I'd be happy to get that for you, Senator.
Thank you. I'll hold you to it.
Okay.
John Sanders, Acting Commissioner of Customs and Border Protection, I mentioned, told me last week that children have no cots or beds. Kids are sleeping on floors or benches with Mylar blankets. Children were sleeping outside under a bridge in El Paso. And my understanding is 6 have died in the past year while in immigration custody or shortly after release. They include a 2-year-old Wilmer Ramirez, who died in May after he and his mother were released from border custody. Was Wilmer Ramirez one of those detained under the El Paso Bridge?
I don't know the answer to that question.
I'd like to get the answer,
okay.
Please. Thank you. Are regular screenings for all children by staff with pediatric training occurring? If not, why not?
So we've dramatically increased our medical care at Border Patrol stations and ports of entry with the support of the FY19 bill. It's proven inadequate to the flow. We've gone from about 20 medical professionals supporting us at the border to over 200, and we're continuing to expand that care. They're not all pediatricians, though. We're talking about certified medical practitioners, but we have sought advice from pediatricians, both through the Homeland Security Advisory Council and through Acting Commissioner Sanders' efforts to engage the medical community to make sure that we're providing the right screenings as people arrive at the border.
Can you tell me where those 200 are based?
I can give you a breakdown by station and port of entry. Yes.
Would you do that, please, in writing?
Happy to do that.
I'd like to go myself and take a look.
Okay.
Okay.
I think you're also going to see uniformed Public Health Service Commission Corps professionals, Coast Guard Medical Corps. This is a whole of government effort to try to protect children in this flow. If I could add one other point, Senator, you mentioned the conditions in our custody. With respect, I testified to inappropriate conditions in our custody in December when we were at 60,000. I've gone on record in the press conference on March 27th at the border right next to that overpass saying, this is unacceptable. The border is at its breaking point. We need help. We need legislation. We need additional funds. Secretary Nielsen sent a letter on the 28th asking Congress to support change in the law and additional funds to address the crisis. We sent 40 days ago our supplemental request, which would alleviate these conditions. It has not been responded to. So I share your concern about these conditions. I've been raising that for months on end. June of last year was the first time I called this a border and humanitarian crisis in the public. June of last year, and we've not seen action, respectfully.
Well, let me just say one thing. We've met. I'm very impressed by your sincerity. I may be foolish, but I don't think I am. And I thank you for that. I think we've got misunderstanding, but we've also got a huge problem with these families and children. And I think that everything you can do to see that they're linked up with their parents and the trauma of what's happening to them is reduced to the smallest extent possible is really what Americans should do. Children should not be the victims in all of this. Adults are somewhat different, but children should not. Has DHS conducted a review of conditions at ICE detention facilities?
This is a comprehensive review process that's managed both within the ICE component as well as at the Inspector General's level, our Office of Civil Rights and Civil Liberties, and in response to various court orders. Their standards are very high. We do have issues from time to time. The issues that were identified in the recent GAO report, the major ones were corrected immediately, and we're on path to make corrections to all the issues identified in that oversight.
Do you do these reviews periodically?
Yes, they have requirements.
What is the period?
I can get you the entire review policy for ICE.
Would you please?
Yes, there are requirements.
I think that would be a good thing for us to take
monthly,
a look at.
Monthly, annually, at various levels.
Thank you. And what steps are taken to correct violations?
So very, very tailored steps to address the specific violation. Some things are harder than others, right? If you have a situation where the standards require a drain in the barbershop or a specific type of law library, sometimes those are harder to correct over time. But these are the kind of standards and violations
libraries.
We're hearing about. Any issue that affects the safety of detainees is addressed immediately.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Very quickly, Senator Lee's next. What are the conditions like on the journey itself?
They can be tremendously horrific.
Are there any
and
medical
dangerous.
Personnel on the journey between Central America?
No, smugglers are not very concerned about the welfare of the people they're trafficking.
So when they get here, we'd like to make it better because it's inadequate by our standards. But compared to the journey itself, don't you think we need to stop these journeys?
Of course. Yeah, we actually see tremendous relief as it's the first safe place these people have been in for weeks on end.
Senator Lee.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. Thank you for your service, Mr. McElhinney. We've got over 140,000 migrants apprehended in May alone. There is unquestionably a problem at our border. It's a crisis. It's not a manufactured crisis. It's not a fake crisis. It's not a crisis that is exaggerated. If anything, it's been understated. So I think it's time for us to fix the problem. And in order to fix the problem, I think we have to fix our laws. Tragically, many in Congress have been unwilling to fix the underlying problem. Indeed, even after President Trump took significant steps toward addressing the problem, with our laws in the last few days, some have responded, even within Congress, by mocking his efforts. And so I don't think this is a good time for flippancy or for political attacks. We need to get to work to restore the integrity, the manageability of our asylum system. Because of the Flores settlement agreement and other loopholes in the law, only 3.5% of unaccompanied alien children who enter this country are removed and sent back to their home countries. Acting Secretary McElhinney, do you have any doubt that such a low removal rate tends to incentivize more migration and more illegal smuggling of these minors?
I don't have any doubt. I know it's a direct cause.
And a related problem is that humanitarian needs of those who are being used as pawns in this massive international human trafficking racket also burden DHS operations. In other words, as we have to devote 40% of the Border Patrol's resources to addressing these humanitarian issues, it creates other problems. Do you think that with CBP being forced to use its own scarce resources to process and care for asylum seekers, are the cartels by chance having an easier time bringing dangerous narcotics and other bad things into our communities?
We know they are. It's a specific tactic that we've seen used in five different sectors on the border where cartels will use large groups of families as a diversionary tactic to smuggle drugs in behind them. Unfortunately, it happens all the time on the border. And when you have 50% in some sectors, it was 40% when we were back in March at the level of 14,000 in custody. In the last week of May, we hit 19,000 in Border Patrol and CBP custody at the border. At that level, you're dealing with 50% of your staff focused on processing and care of migrants and not out on the border securing the line.
And as you know, the 20-day limit that we have on the detention of alien minors forces DHS to engage in what some describe as a catch-and-release program to ensure that there are real consequences for illegal entry. I think we need to be able to detain people who are coming in and claiming asylum long enough to evaluate their claims under our asylum laws. So taking into account the possibility of continuances and the fact that under current regulations, an alien is entitled to a certain number of days at various stages of an adjudication to file briefs and to make appeals, how long does it take realistically to adjudicate fully an asylum claim?
Yeah, helpfully, this is not a hypothetical question because we had this authority in the past administration and Secretary Johnson at the time established family residential centers, which provide an appropriate setting for families to stay together while they're going through an immigration proceeding. The average time for those proceedings was between 40 and 50 days. So we've been able to do this efficiently and effectively before to actually get immigration results. And if someone has a valid asylum claim, release them. If not, to repatriate them efficiently and create that integrity in the system that's necessary.
So we've done that. We've done that in the last few years.
Yes.
We did that not in this administration, but in the Obama administration.
Correct.
So why couldn't it work today?
Because we're under a court order, a single district court in the Ninth Circuit, that prevents us from detaining families more than 20 days at a time.
Is there any appreciable difference in the time it takes to adjudicate a claim for withholding of removal versus a claim for asylum?
I don't believe so, no.
So far this year, we've apprehended 444,509 migrants from the three Northern Triangle countries of Guatemala, Honduras, and El Salvador. That translates to about 1.32% of the total population of those countries, and many of those individuals, the more than 444,000 I mentioned, are people who are claiming asylum. If Central American countries, or people from Central American countries, were required to file refugee applications in their home countries and were barred from seeking asylum, would the administration see that as a justification to raise the refugee cap currently set at 30,000?
I think that's something that we can discuss. So right now, Secretary Pompeo set the cap for Central America at over 3,000, and we've not nearly met that total because people are not applying safely in country. They're instead paying smugglers and because they gain an advantage from coming unlawfully. We think it would be much better if they applied in a safe place near or at their home country, and then we could consider that case there.
Okay. So theoretically, that's possible.
Yes.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Senator Durbin.
Thank you for being here, and thank you for the cooperation in my visit to the border in El Paso. I want to address one issue right off the bat here. We live in a political world in Washington, D.C., where inconvenient and embarrassing facts are dismissed as fake news. Now we are hearing that inconvenient and embarrassing information about children is being dismissed as recycled children. Fake kids. This is the second time we've had testimony and questions asked about the so-called DNA testing for those who are fraudulently representing that certain children are their own. Now, there is no excuse for that, and I'm not going to make any. But I'd like to ask you point blank, because I've asked repeatedly, when are you going to provide us with the information on this so we know how many tests there have been, how many have failed on the DNA side, and whether it is an appreciable percentage or a phenomenon which should be a source of great concern, but should not lead us to dismiss what's happening to children in this process.
Happy to answer that question right now, Senator.
Please.
Okay, we did a three-day DNA pilot. 109 people were tested in that pilot. These were targeted based on Border Patrol observations and concerns that there might not be a family relationship. So I want to get that clear up front. 17 admitted or were tested out as fraudulent. 9 of them said, "This is not my child. I don't want to take the test," as they came forward to take the test. This is a 15% return. In that same time period,
you're not suggesting that 15% of the children who are coming across the border with adults are in fact fraudulently represented as being the children of these adults, are you?
That's why I was careful to say that these were targeted referrals by Border Patrol agents who had a concern about
the point I want to get to is this
relationship. Can I just add one other point, Senator? The other HSI interviews, we've had special agents with forensic interview skills down on the border now. They've done 1,568 interviews of family units. 242 were fraudulent. Same type of referral based on risk from a Border Patrol observation. But again, that's a 15% return. I don't think we can ignore these numbers.
No, we should not ignore them. And there is no excuse, none, for misrepresenting that a child is your own in an effort to defraud anyone in our country or any other place. But this notion that we can somehow dismiss the 85% of children because some are abusing that representation of parental responsibility troubles me greatly. Did you believe the zero tolerance policy was a good policy?
So I've testified in this committee that that policy was not successful because we lost the public trust, and it's appropriate that the president ended it over almost a year ago, June 20th of 2018.
I'm not going to quote some things that you said about it before it was implemented, because we all can learn from mistakes. I think the president learned from that mistake, and one of the few times I can remember that he said he was wrong in the course of 2.5 years. But the point I want to get to is this. There were thousands, according to the Inspector General's report, thousands who were also detained, apart from children separated, before the zero tolerance policy was announced. Were you aware of that as well?
So, and we've talked about this as well, Senator. The zero tolerance policy, it lasted 6 weeks. It was prosecuting adults who crossed with children.
How many children were separated from adults in that 6 weeks?
In that 6 week period, we can get you the exact number.
I'll give you the number. It's 2,880. That's what the judge found in Southern California.
You're right, Senator. That's the HHS filing, and that's the best place to respond to those court orders and that specific set of parameters.
But that was a mistake. Do you not agree that was a mistake?
Senator, I've already acknowledged that it was not an effective policy,
so,
and it lost the public
trust. Do
you
believe that returning children now to their countries of origin without follow-up to make certain that they are protected or at least in a safe situation when they're returned,
I think a better
would also be a mistake?
A better and balanced policy than what we're doing today, which is inviting parents to put their children in the hands of smugglers, would be to allow them to claim their protection safely in country, and if they avoid that or they don't merit it, to be able to repatriate them in accordance with the host government.
And this administration shut down the Central American project that allowed that to occur under the Obama administration. Is that correct?
So the problem is you need to have balance. You need to be able to provide
access to protection in country. I think a yes or no is in order, Mr. McLennan.
And you need to be able to repatriate people who don't warrant it.
You didn't answer the question. Did this administration shut down the Obama policy that allowed for those who wished children to apply for asylum status in their home countries?
The Central American Minors Program, which was a program that resulted in some children getting status, but most being paroled into the U.S. with no future of legal status.
Was it shut down by the Trump administration?
Yes.
Please. Yes. Let me ask you about those who show up for hearings, asylum hearings. I think it's a premise of what the chairman asked you earlier, and I think what you told us was that 87% don't appear. 92% of individuals who filed asylum claims attended their court hearings between fiscal years 2013 and 2017. Asylum seekers released from detention to pursue their claims attend immigration court hearings nearly 100% of the time. 98% of mothers with children who were represented by legal counsel complied with court hearing obligations. I've been to these immigration courts. It is hard for me as a lawyer and someone who is focusing to try to figure out the continuances and what's being said at these hearings. Imagine if I didn't speak the native language that's being spoken at these hearings. What we have found is directly the opposite of what you've said to the chairman. Overwhelmingly, if these people are given any kind of counseling about the legal process or legal representation, they show up over 90% of the time. It's not the so-called, and I hate the term, catch and release that's being represented to this committee. Do you acknowledge that?
So you're using specific types of data. I'm going to give you some additional data. One of the programs this committee has favored is a family case management program that ICE administered a year and a half ago. Those families did appear for their court hearings, but now we've seen 150 with final orders of removal not actually show up to be removed, to be repatriated. They had access to counsel, they showed up for their proceedings, and they are at large and not following the law. That's the kind of concern we have here. I gave you the recent numbers of over 7,000 families that we put through a process to try to get court results more quickly. 90% of them did not show up for their hearings.
The last thing I'd like to ask is this. Do you recognize the name Betty Rendon?
I do not.
Well, I'll remind you. It was the Lutheran seminary student, the woman who was a grandparent, who was in the Chicagoland area and was recently deported with her husband. She's the grandmother of American citizens. She's been in this country for 15 years. ICE pursued her through her daughter, who was covered by DACA, arrested her and her husband, and deported them from this country. That's the kind of thing when people read about it, as we did in the Chicago media, and hear requests for more money for ICE, we say to ourselves, if you have this crisis at the border, humanitarian crisis, and if you have people who are clearly a danger in the United States and undocumented, why are these not the priority instead of Betty Rendon?
There's always going to be sympathetic individual cases when you're enforcing immigration law. What my responsibility is working with ICE to make sure that their priorities are appropriate. 9 out of 10 of their interior enforcement actions have criminal records.
This woman had no criminal record.
I understand that you're referencing a case I'm not familiar with, but I'm trying to explain that, by and large, we've got 75% of ICE intake is from the border, 25% is from the interior, and out of that 25%, 9 out of 10 have criminal records.
Well, these are the cases that come to our attention. Why are we wasting money deporting this woman instead of dealing with the humanitarian crisis and anyone who's truly dangerous?
Senator Hawley's next, but I want to try to see if I understand what Senator Durbin was saying. So if you have counsel and there's a system that you feel comfortable with where somebody can interpret it and have counsel, that the attendance rates are greater, is that fair to say?
Dramatically.
I think that's fair to say. I'm not endorsing any specific stats. We'd like to present them from the government
side. Well, that makes sense to me. But is it also fair to say what you're finding is if they lose the case, they don't show up for their deportation?
We are seeing that, yes, unfortunately. Right. And that requires ICE to go into a community to effectuate that order of removal.
But okay. Mr. Chairman, can I ask?
Sure.
And at the moment, when they are denied that status, they could be deported, correct?
Pardon me?
When they are denied an asylum status at the end of the hearing, they could be deported at that point, right?
They can, but ICE has to go into a community to effectuate that if they don't have
a maintained
status. They're
in a hearing setting when this is announced, isn't it?
No, the immigration judges often don't issue the final order until weeks after the last hearing, and so you actually have to get someone to report.
I think you're both right. Senator Hawley.
I'd like to talk about the safety of children at the border, to go back to that important line of questioning. You testified in your written testimony that you've uncovered child recycling rings, I'm quoting you now, whereby innocent children are being used multiple times to help different adults gain illegal entry and release. Can you tell us more about that? Because it seems to me that the exploitation of children by cartels, human smugglers, on the scale that you're describing is absolutely unbelievable. And quite frankly, the refusal of this Congress to act, to do something about this humanitarian crisis, is absolutely unbelievable and absolutely indefensible. So why don't you tell us more about this crisis?
So in May, we had 88,000 families cross the border. That's incentivized by the fact that they can't be held for the full court proceeding. We know that for a fact. It's not a great leap of imagination to think that people might try to exploit that fact and bring a child who's not their own, maybe even the same child more than once. You referenced the cases of child recycling. We're up to 3 significant cases now. The Charleston case was referenced, but we also have one in Chicago where we had a single group. 8 children were used to bring in 36 adults.
These are rings we're talking about, 3 different instances of recycling rings.
Correct.
Yep.
That, to me, is indicative of the challenge we're facing, and we're very concerned. We've only identified the tip of the iceberg in terms of these cases. We need to continue to invest in protecting these children, but better yet, a change in the law would prevent this cycle from happening in the first place.
You testified earlier about renting children. I think, was it $89 a child? Is that the figure that you gave? Did I write that down correctly?
So one of the individuals that was subject to DNA testing, one of those 109, was a 51-year-old. He said, sorry, it's not my child. It was a 6-month-old child that he stated he paid about $80, the equivalent of $80 to rent from the mother.
Who's making the money here? I mean, who's making money on recycling children and renting children?
Human smugglers, human smuggling organizations.
And what's the role of the cartels in all of this at the border?
They advertise it. They promote it. It's ubiquitous in Central America. Advertisements on radio, advertisements on social media, the advertisement the chairman held up at the start of the meeting. This is a very well-known fact.
So, you know, it just strikes me. I mean, we've heard it said that crossing the southern border is an act of love. But for the cartels, It is an opportunity for exploitation of children. It is an opportunity to cash in. It is about profit. It is about money. It's about their criminal enterprise. Is that fair to say?
Absolutely.
And you said just a little bit ago that it was last June that you said we have a humanitarian crisis at the border. Is that right?
That's right.
And you've requested additional funding. You've requested humanitarian assistance. You've requested more judges. And this Congress has refused to act, refused to act, refused to act. Is that correct?
Yes.
I don't think failure to act is really quite right. I think that's way too generous. It is refusal to act, because Congress could act. They could act if they wanted to, but they don't want to. That's the bottom line. And so we're dealing with children. I'm the father of two little boys. The idea that you would have children recycled, purchased, used for profit by these cartels and by these smuggling rings, and that this Congress would sit by and say, we're just not going to do anything, there really is no crisis, there's nothing we can agree on, is absolutely unbelievable to me. I mean, it is the worst failure of leadership that I can think of. I mean, it's absolutely stunning. Let me ask you about one of the proposals that the chairman has made, the refugee processing centers in Mexico and Central America. How much of a difference would that make for Border Patrol and DHS if migrants from the Northern Triangle were able to apply for refugee status in their home country?
Yeah, part of the problem here is that we do have a percentage of people that have valid refugee or asylum type cases that deserve protections. And right now they're caught within that huge flow of others that are just economic migrants who are exploiting the loopholes. If we had a refugee processing center in country, we'd be able to do that in a safe place and get a result for those people that need protections, fly them safely to a destination country, could be the United States, could be another country that would offer protections, and it would be a much better process without smugglers involved, without profits for criminals.
It would help remove, right, those incentives that the cartels, the smuggling rings have in order to exploit children and to use them for profit. Is that fair to say?
Right, while still reaching those that need protections.
Yeah, because what we have are, we do have families that are desperately seeking asylum. We do have some that are going to have a valid refugee or asylum claims. And we have others who want to escape the conditions of their home country, understandably. And then you've got these cartels and smuggling rings who are preying upon that, who are finding ways to violate the law and turning all of that into their own profit. Is that right?
Exactly right.
Just on the details of this proposal, do you have a view on whether such refugee processing centers should be run by DHS or by the State Department, or how that ought to work?
Yeah, I mean, the State Department and the UNHCR are the organizations that manage refugee processing foreign.
And do you think that that's a good, or you'd be happy with that arrangement?
Yeah, DHS has a role with Citizenship and Immigration Services. It's a partnership. I mean, it should be treated like the situation it is, like an international refugee challenge.
Very good. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Senator Klobuchar.
Thank you. Acting Secretary, why do you think this problem is so much worse than it was during the previous administration?
Because of the loopholes in the legislation, the Flores regulation that's been reinterpreted after the last administration successfully started repatriating families and reduced the crisis in 14. It was reinterpreted by a court, upheld by the Ninth Circuit, and here we are.
And do you think it has nothing to do with the inconsistencies of this administration's policies, with the threats about the wall, within the threats about changes in policies, with the tweets, with the limits in foreign aid, that this would in fact be something that would create incentives for people to come up north, and then in fact is amplified by the smugglers, and they use the president's words and his threats to create even more uncertainty and more people coming up north? Do you think that is a factor at all?
So the smugglers will use whatever they can, and they
no,
do misadvertise.
Do you think it's a factor at all, the president's actions in creating more migration?
No, I think this is an unbroken challenge with family units increasing. We had a crisis the last 3 months of 2016 around the election, if you recall, with a huge surge.
So you think the administration's policies have nothing to do with this, what's happening right now?
I don't know how you ascribe the administration's policies to try to secure the border to pulling more people across.
Do you think comprehensive immigration reform that we passed in 2013 in the Senate, that was supported by President Obama, that got blocked by the Republican leadership in the House, do you think that would have helped to prevent this from happening with all the funding that was there for the border and also having a much more orderly process for legal immigration?
So I think there are a number of very beneficial things about that bill, including the border security investments, which I helped advise Chairman Graham and the committee, several committee members on during that time. I was deputy commissioner of CBP. I also believe that the lawful access to immigration was important as well. But I don't believe that this issue was addressed in that bill. This issue of
but you know that there was money was for judges and asylum processing. There was money for creating a more orderly process at the border that we now don't have. And I note that that 2013 bill, the CBO score on that, the Congressional Budget Office nonpartisan score, were the reason that Grover Norquist supported the bill. Was that it brought the debt down by $158 billion. And when you think of that kind of cash and what you could do with that money, if you took a portion of it with much going into debt reduction, that could have been used for order at the border, do you think that would have been helpful?
Many beneficial elements of that bill.
Okay, so let's go back to Senator Durbin's question about shutting down the process that the current administration shut down in 2017 that would allow asylum seekers to be able to apply in their countries. Do you think that was helpful when that was shut down?
So I don't think it was an appropriate program because it didn't lead to legal status for most of the people that were paroled into the U.S. I think what we've proposed, and is in this Mr. Chairman's bill, it would allow us to provide access to protections in country, but also to repatriate those that avoid that access or that didn't qualify.
And so so the administration now favors bringing back a similar program to this?
With the protections and the integrity of the system, if people avoid it and cross unlawfully anyway, yes.
But there was something in place before. And then how about the foreign aid, the president's threat to cut foreign aid to those three countries? Do you think that's been helpful?
So the aid has been frozen to ensure that we have accountable partners and targeted programs that are making an impact, that have a return on investment. I think we need to continue to work with partners in Central America. That's certainly my position as an acting secretary, recommending that to partners at state and to the White House, and I'll continue to advocate.
And I go back here to this comprehensive reform, where again, if we did something like that, we would actually have a way to pay for part of this to try to resolve this problem. When I spoke to you at this previous hearing, I asked you if you had any regrets about how the family separation policy was implemented. And you said that when law enforcement lose the public trust, they can't be effective. That was a quote. What is the status of the investigation into those deaths? And will you commit to publicly releasing the results and attempting to earn back the public's trust?
So you're talking about which deaths, Senator? I'm sorry.
Six children and dying in CBP custody shortly after they were released since last December.
Okay, yes. There have been three deaths of unaccompanied or children with parents in CBP custody this fiscal year. All are under investigation. We have the medical examiner's reports now for both Jacqueline Calmaquin and Felipe Alonso Gomez. We do not have the final Inspector General reports yet, and I will absolutely share those with this committee if they won't be shared directly, and we'll be following up on any identified recommendations. What I can tell you is that from those incidents, we've invested heavily in the care of children in our custody, especially the medical care, since that time.
Okay, and I would look forward to seeing those reports, and I'll ask you in writing a question about siblings being separated, which I'd asked about at that previous hearing. According to reports 2 months ago, the president offered to pardon you if you were convicted of having border agents block asylum seekers from entering the U.S. in defiance of U.S. law. Has anyone from the White House asked you to violate the law?
No, no one has asked me to do anything illegal.
Is a president instructing subordinates to violate the law and promising to shield them from legal consequences by pardoning them consistent with his oath of office and the requirement in the Constitution that he take care that the laws be faithfully executed?
I've never been asked to do anything unlawful, nor would I.
Last question. According to Brookings Institute report released last October, the administration has a 5% success rate when defending its agency actions in court. Previous administrations, including Republicans ones, have an average 69% success rate when defending their actions. Some of these agency actions have come from the DHS. I'm not going to go through all the details. You know what they are with TPS, DACA, other things. This suggests that the administration is taking actions that are far outside of the mainstream, the legal mainstream, including with Republican-appointed judges. How do you explain this sharp decline in success rate?
I think we don't have results in all of those cases yet. Many of them are under appeal and currently in process.
Okay. I was just using the Brookings numbers, but thank you.
Next, we have Senator Blackburn, but I don't actually really important question to me. If we had passed the Gang of Eight bill, do you agree that most of the problems we're dealing with, not all, would not exist?
We'd have a very different situation. We'd have 20,000 additional Border Patrol agents. We'd have technology comprehensively deployed.
The country would be much better off with that bill.
We'd be a lot more secure on the border, the elements that would have supported CBP and ICE.
Senator Blackburn. Oh, I'm sorry, Kennedy. Kennedy, I apologize.
Mr. Secretary, I think you're doing a good job. The best job that you can under the circumstances. I've listened to you in two hearings. I don't think you're a politician. I think you're doing the best you can to solve this problem. And I appreciate that. Can you tell me what a safe third party or safe third country agreement is?
Sure. There's a provision in our immigration law, and it's an international standard as well, where you're acknowledging that another government's asylum process is full and fair, and it should be recognized so that an asylum seeker can't cross through another country and then choose to enter yours and claim asylum if they were already in a safe place.
Does it mean that if you're trying to make it to the United States, or strike that, if you're trying to make it to Mexico, let's say, but you step foot in the United States first, and you're seeking asylum status, then the United States has to prosecute your asylum status.
Right. That if you're already in a country where you're not going to be persecuted,
right,
where you have access to,
right,
asylum, you shouldn't be allowed to move to another country to claim it.
If we made, or we inserted a safe third party or safe third country agreement into the USMCA, that would stop this problem cold, wouldn't it?
So I've long advocated for partnership between destination and transit countries on migration.
Would that solve this problem?
I think a safe third country agreement with Mexico or other governments where we see transit would be a very effective way at addressing the flow.
And if we put it in the USMCA, it would apply to Mexico, the United States, and Canada equally. Is that right?
So I'm not sure how the legislation would be crafted or whether it could or should be attached to the USMCA, but we do have a safe 30 country agreement with Canada. It's not fully effective because it doesn't apply between ports of entry. And having one with another partner country like Mexico would be very beneficial.
Well, let me put it this way. The agreement that I'm envisioning would say, as a part of the USMCA, if someone is seeking asylum status in one of the three countries, the country in which they land first, so long as it is a safe country, is the country responsible for processing the asylum declaration.
I think that's a sensible approach that could work in North America and has worked in the context of Europe and Turkey, Norway and Russia, and elsewhere around the world.
Do you happen to know, has your department quantified the cost of the American taxpayer per asylum claim?
I don't have that on hand, but we could do some analysis there.
Could you get that for him?
Okay.
Can you tell me how much the American people have spent in money to the Northern Triangle countries trying to fix them so people don't want to leave?
Well, under the Alliance for Prosperity, more recently, it's been in the range of $500 million a year. A lot of that money is still yet to be deployed, though.
For how long?
I think that's been going on for 3 years.
Okay, so we spent $1.5 billion. It obviously hasn't worked.
Well, that's why I think there's a temporary freeze on the aid to make sure that the programs are functioning effectively.
How much money would the American taxpayer have to spend in Guatemala, El Salvador, Honduras, to reduce, to make their country, those countries, so much better that 20% fewer people wouldn't want to leave?
Well, I think the chairman's point earlier that there's no near-term ability to make the countries so welcoming that it's not still better to try to migrate to the U.S. if we have legal loopholes. I think that's a really critical
point. So what would we spend the money on?
So I think economic development for our region is beneficial. I think security and governance is critical. We have gang activities that are transnational that do affect the safety of Americans that originate in these three countries, and
we
should
be
partnering with them.
So we would spend this money on economic development in the Northern Triangle?
So I'll give you an example, Senator, of something that DHS controls in this area. We have the customs responsibility. These countries have very inefficient customs systems. There are long delays at their borders. There are unnecessary supply chain barriers that are causing economic costs. We can give them advice relatively cheaply, give them system support, and they can really increase their commerce and activity and create some of the jobs that are necessary to reduce their gap. That's the kind of thing that I think
What's
is smart
to support them. What's your best estimate of how much it will cost to reduce the flow by 20%?
And just with aid alone, because I don't advocate for an aid-only approach.
But aid'll get. I mean, I hear you're saying, or at least some of my colleagues have said that giving them aid will reduce the flow. It'll make people less likely to leave their country. And I'm saying, how much do you think it will take to reduce the flow by 20%?
Yeah, and I don't have a sound estimate for you on that. I think there are some case studies we could look at in El Salvador with Plan El Salvador Seguro. The 60% drop in the murder rate and the reduction in migration we saw last year might be an instructive place to look. But
I get it.
It's hard to estimate sitting here, Senator.
We don't know, do we? Okay. Let me ask you one last question. If 90% of the people who are in our country illegally are showing up for their hearings, how did we get 11 million people in our country illegally?
Yeah, that's why I recommended we go back and provide comprehensive data on the different categories. In our experience, majority of people aren't showing up for their hearings, and those that do get a final order get it in absentia for the most part and are not being repatriated effectively, which is why we have this draw and this pull factor.
All right. Last one. When counsel is provided for our neighbors who come here illegally, who pays for the counsel?
It would be the American taxpayer.
And do you know how much we're paying in legal fees?
Well, we're not doing that right now. We did get appropriations in 19 to try again with a family case management program to see if they could have successful results.
Can you get me a number quantified on the cost per asylum applicant?
If there were to be comprehensive counsel provided or historically?
No, not just lawyers, everything.
Oh.
How much is this costing the American people?
We can do that.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Senator Hirano.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. You said that you think that there is a multi-prong approach that's needed to deal with the situation of the crisis. And would you agree that addressing the root causes of migration with foreign aid is one of those prongs?
Yes.
And I think you testified that there's a temporary freeze on this kind of aid, something in the order of $450 million. So, what was the explanation for the temporary freeze on the aid to these countries?
Concerns that it was not being applied effectively actually meet the purposes of the legislation and the appropriation.
It could take a long time for the administration to figure out that this aid is not being appropriately utilized. So, in the meantime, we're not getting on with what we need to do, which I think is, as you testified earlier, that we do need to get to the root causes of what prompts so many of these families to come to our country seeking asylum. So, this is a long-term kind of a commitment on our part to enable them to become much more economically strong, to institute a rule of law, to end corruption. So it's going to take years. I think that part of what was tried was in Colombia, where our country sent a lot of aid, and now Colombia's economy is stronger, and we don't see the kind of situation that would prompt the Colombians to come to our country. So, you know, I think that Others of my colleagues have talked about how important the continuation of aid is, with appropriate parameters, of course. And that is up to us to establish and make sure that those parameters are followed. So since you acknowledge that this will require a multi-pronged approach, not just changing the laws, and we have different views on that point, do you think that the Trump administration is following a multi-pronged approach to good effect?
I think so. And if I could just clarify that the freeze that's undertaken right now has not yet affected some of the key programs that have been in process and funded under prior year appropriations. We have months to assess which programs are working, and that's going to ultimately be the Secretary of State's recommendation, the President's determination.
So how much of the $500 million or so in aid that we generally provide is being provided at this point?
I'll reach out to the Department of State to make sure the committee has that information.
I'm kind of surprised that you did not anticipate that we would ask these kinds of questions, because you had testified earlier that it's really important for us to get to the root causes. So there have been times when you have, with probably all good intentions, to provide us with information, and then we don't get that information. So I, for one, think that a multi-pronged approach is really necessary. I agree with you on that, and I think that we're not doing enough on getting to the root causes, so there's that. Senator Feinstein asked you how many children have been separated from their parents since June of 2018. Last year, you said you didn't know the exact number, so this is after the zero tolerance policy was ended. So doesn't CBP keep track of the children that it has separated from after the zero tolerance policy?
We do. We keep careful track.
But
we have that number. I gave you the percentage this morning, but we'll get you the exact number.
Well, so that's another thing, because you know that the zero tolerance policy resulted in a huge hue and cry and outrage in our country, because our administration, through this policy, created instant orphans of thousands of these immigrant children. So you know, I think it would behoove you to come to our committee and give us the kind of information that you know we would want to hear, because it would enable us to decide whether the current policies are being where you're separating. We know you're still separating children. In fact, there have been reports that that children are still being separated and not for particularly valid reasons. For example, the government even told a court in San Diego that they separated children because they didn't have enough time to confirm parentage to their satisfaction. So I'd like to know how many children are being separated for these kinds of reasons that you just didn't have time to figure out whether they were with their parents or not.
Yeah, we're talking about 0.5%. It's a very rare situation in this for the safety and welfare of the child under both executive and court order that we manage very carefully and keep track of.
Of course, it's your Border Patrol agents who are making these initial determinations. So it has to do with what kind of training they have and you know, all of those kinds of issues. There's just a multiplicity of concerns that we have, particularly for children who come to our country seeking asylum. Yeah, well, nobody wants to support fraud. That is very clear. Nobody wants to support open borders. But as we deal with this multifaceted problem, there are valid concerns that we have about how children are being treated. So let's get another thing clear. In April in 2019, multiple news reports indicated that President Trump offered to pardon you if you went to jail for following his desired policy of blocking entry of asylum seekers to the United States. And yes, you testified just now that you have not been asked to violate any laws, etc. But yes or no, has President Trump ever offered or suggested that he would pardon you if you implemented his legally suspect immigration policies, including denying entry to asylum seekers, even if you perceived the president's offer of pardoning you to keep you out of jail to be a joke?
I'm just going to repeat myself, Senator. I've not been asked to do anything unlawful, nor
would I. No, that is different. That is not the question I asked. The question is, has the president offered even if you thought it might be in jest, offered to protect you if you ended up going to jail? No, I know you testified that you've not been asked to violate the law. So did he?
I think my
suggestion,
my answer
as
stands,
was reported in the news, because that would be a source of major concern for a lot of us. I do have, Mr. Chairman, some other questions for the record, because this is a very complicated situation. And yes, we would all like to do the humane and appropriate things, including, by the way, we need to do more to stem the cartel's activities. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Senator Rano. Senator Blackburn.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Secretary, thank you so much for your service. I will tell you, this past Friday, as I was in the El Paso sector, I just was really grateful for the men and women that are there and are working. I know you all have brought people in from across the country. I saw a guy from Memphis who was down working, had been down for a few weeks, helping out the Coast Guard, as you mentioned, helping with health and doing some of those screenings. And this is just such a heart-wrenching situation, especially when you look at the children and the unaccompanied alien children. And we know this is an issue. When I was in the House and in 2014 had visited one of the centers, raised concerns and couldn't get bipartisan agreement to do some things at that point. And you know, being down there and visiting with some of these unaccompanied alien children, there was even a one-year-old in that facility. She was there with her mom, who was a minor child, and they were waiting to find out what was going to happen with them. But one of the things that the Office of Refugee Resettlement, one of their actions concerns me, and this is the unreviewable discretion and utilizing that to allow the release of these UACs. Traffickers of these children are really taking advantage of the loopholes that exist, whether it's the rent-a-child policy or sending a child forward, and that child ends up with sex trafficking or labor trafficking or maybe into a gang. And many times these adult sponsors that are seeking the custody are themselves in the country illegally, and they are not related to this child, and they do not have that child's welfare at heart. And Senator Grassley mentioned the accountability for care of the UACs, the bill that we have filed, and it codifies existing agreement between DHS and HHS to share that criminal background history. And I would like to hear from you what else you think we need to be doing to support your agents. We know you need more funding. We know that agents need more manpower, and that we've got a lot of agents down there now that are tending to feeding duties. They are dealing in these centers. Two of the centers I visited, one was built to accommodate 85, the other built to accommodate 123, and now they each have over 1,200. So tell us what we can do to help lessen this burden that we've not discussed yet today.
Okay. Thank you, Senator, and thank you, first of all, for just talking about our men and women, and I appreciate the chairman at the opening also acknowledging that we have tremendous law enforcement professionals that are doing extraordinary work to protect vulnerable populations and work that they're not trained for, they didn't sign up for. They signed up to secure the border, but now they're caring for families and kids, and they're doing it with honor. I do worry very much that it's not sustainable. I worry about their health. I worry about their families, and I appreciate you acknowledging the heart with which they're doing their job. And we do have 325 DHS volunteers down there now supporting. We've got 700 CBP officers from around the country supporting Border Patrol agents, and then, of course, the Coast Guard. What we do need from the supplemental is the funding to provide a better situation so that children are not waiting in those Border Patrol stations that you saw, that they're moving to HHS facilities, including that young mother, very quickly. That's the requirement in law. That's a commitment we should be able to meet. We need the funding to do that. We also need the support for the transportation, the temporary facilities we need to get that crowding down in our stations so that they have room to have a better situation while they're waiting for transfer, and the ability to hold a single adults in ICE custody as we've exceeded our beds. We need all of that funding. You mentioned HHS and the efforts they undertake to ensure that children are placed with sponsors effectively. I know they work very hard at that. The fact, though, that you just raised is that most children are being released to parents, but parents who are here unlawfully. And that's a continued challenge in this cycle. One of the things that we do need is the ability to share information so that we can make sure that all federal law enforcement information that might pertain to the safety of that child when they're released is available to HHS making that determination. And that's a challenge we're facing right now. But the critical needs are that $3.3 billion, 75% of the supplemental going to HHS to provide adequate facilities for unaccompanied children, and then the 25% so that DHS can manage this crisis effectively.
Let's talk a little bit about the wall also. When I was riding with the Border Patrol, within 30 minutes, we saw 12 people just come walking right up, raise their hands, want amnesty, and they're coming across where there is no wall, and they're walking right across that dry riverbed. Now, if a U.S. citizen was in Mexico and walked across that riverbed, they would be arrested for unlawful entry and disobeying our immigration laws. But with it being someone who is not a U.S. citizen, we are taking them in, and the process begins. In that Santa Teresa station, there were about 1,000 migrants that were there, Guatemala, El Salvador, Honduras, Cuba, a large group of Cubans that were there. But one of the things that is so vital is to have that wall. And I heard it from every single agent. And just for the record, speak a little bit about that physical deterrence, its need, and how many miles you have under construction right now.
Right. So the request for additional barrier on the border comes from our agents on the ground who need it to control key areas of the border where we have high traffic or where there's an ability to disappear on the U.S. side into infrastructure or into transportation very quickly. It's a stated, known requirement. We've had it for decades, and we've applied wall or barrier effectively in multiple sectors on the border, and we need more of it. Right now, we're building the wall funding appropriated in 18 and 19. We finished the 17 build already. That's about 40 miles. The 18 funding covers about 85, and we're already applying the funding for 19 as well, going as fast as we can to get that additional barrier up. And again, it comes with cameras, with sensors, with lighting, with roads, with all kinds of important function for our agents to effectively secure those areas of border. And we absolutely do need it to address those that are trying to evade capture. We do have the problem of people presenting to agents, but we've got about 30% are trying to evade capture. They include drug smugglers, criminals, and gang members that we need to stop effectively.
My time's expired. I appreciate the work that you and the Border Patrol are continuing to do. Yield back.
Thank you.
Senator Blumenthal.
Thanks, Mr. Chairman. I want to join my colleagues in thanking the very dedicated and courageous members of the Customs and Border Protection, as well as the other professionals who work day in and day out on basically doing their jobs under very difficult conditions. And I visited them on multiple occasions and have always been impressed with their dedication to their work. So nothing I'm about to say, I don't think anything said here casts aspersions on them. Yesterday, President Trump tweeted, and I'm quoting, quote, "We have fully signed and documented another very important part of the immigration and security deal with Mexico, one that the United States has been asking about getting for many years. It will be revealed in the not too distant future and will need a vote by Mexico's legislative body," end quote. What is the secret deal?
Yeah. So I'm certainly not going to share something in advance of the president who's referenced.
Is there a secret deal?
So the deal with Mexico is a comprehensive approach, and it's more than we've ever had in terms of commitment from Mexico, both operationally, both
and,
on the program,
how much
the border,
of it, though,
and
is,
in policy.
How much of it is not yet disclosed to the American public?
So they announced the operational efforts, 6,000 at their southern border, addressing transportation nodes, partnering with us on our shared border. The migrant protection protocol is being expanded to all 26 stations.
I know what he's announced, but the the Foreign Secretary of Mexico denies there is any sort of undisclosed deal. How do you square that statement with the president's?
So I think the president's tweet stands for itself, and the announcement will be on his timeline. What I can show you, though, is the further actions in the announcement talk about continued assessment over 90 days. Looking at this, Secretary Pompeo said we're going to look at
With all due respect, because my time is limited, I know what has been said. If you are unable to disclose anything more about what's in this deal, I think, with all due respect, you are failing in your duty to come before this committee and fully disclose what the commitments of this nation are with respect to immigration. And maybe you can tell us what the timeline is.
Respectfully, I would defer to the president's own statements on that matter and the coordination with the government of Mexico.
Let me ask you about reports of a breach of data involving the images of faces and license plates taken by apparently a company called Perceptix of Tennessee at the border. How many facial photographs and license plate images have been disclosed improperly?
Yeah. So my understanding from CBP, and they did disclose and report to Congress as required by law as soon as this came to light. We're talking about a few lanes at a single port of entry, a test for about a month and a half. That's the source of the data. So this is not a widespread issue. It's a land border vehicle crossing. It's something they're investigating aggressively right now. And we're going to absolutely disclose our findings and take corrective action. I can tell you that no CBP systems or DHS systems were breached in this incident.
It was the system of a contractor, Perceptive.
That's correct. Correct?
Wouldn't you agree that CBP has the same responsibility with respect to a contractor that it's hired and paid to maintain proper security over photographs of travelers and license plates that have been exposed as a result of a cyber attack? Doesn't your agency have the same responsibility there that it has over its own activities?
Yes, that's why it was immediately reported and why they're following up aggressively.
And are you sure that it is only at one point of entry that the breach has occurred?
That's our information at this time, yes.
And what is the timeline for completing that investigation?
Well, it's a top priority, right? Any privacy breach requires immediate action to understand how many people are affected, what kind of information was disclosed, and how we can mitigate that issue. So we will give you an update in a matter of weeks on what we've learned in that.
But you are alarmed, I hope, that this kind of breach has occurred about information concerning travelers and license plates that could be very harmful to them and certainly is a breach of their privacy.
Right. Any data breach is alarming. My understanding is this one is a limited impact right now, but we're going to fully review it and report the findings.
There was a reference earlier to that 2013 agreement, or I should say a bill, that was approved with overwhelming bipartisan support by this committee and then by the Senate of the United States, and I was proud to be a part of helping to draft it. Did you support it at the time?
So as I've noted, I was in an operational position. I provided a lot of technical assistance on what would be effective for us operationally at the border, and a lot of that was included, absolutely supported those provisions that would have made an impact on our border security.
And I recognize, because I was there at the time, that you provided a lot of expertise and support. Would you support it now?
I would support a number of key elements of that bill, and you know, I'd refer to the White House announcement of an offer to engage in a broad conversation on immigration, and support a bill that would address border security issues, port of entry infrastructure. Those are the DHS
elements.
What
about a path to earn citizenship for 11 million people who are undocumented?
Right. So I think the president's talked about willingness to discuss DACA in the context of a broader security bill. I don't believe the administration policy has addressed path to citizenship more broadly, nor would I suggest
so
that support.
You would not state a position at this point in favor of either a path for DACA
Right.
Or for the 11 million undocumented individuals.
So what I would say is the president's expressed support for Chairman Graham's bill to a targeted solution to this crisis and has offered to engage in a broader conversation on immigration with a number of provisions that I think could gain bipartisan support and should be discussed by this body.
Let me just ask you finally, what is the dollar amount necessary to address the humanitarian crisis at the border? We've all agreed there is a humanitarian crisis in housing, medical care, education, basic necessities. What is the dollar amount necessary?
The emergency supplemental request submitted on May 1st is $4.5 billion, 75% of which is simply for the care and custody of unaccompanied children by HHS.
And that's sufficient in your view?
At the current flow numbers, you know, the flow has continued to go up. We did submit some revised numbers to the Appropriations Committee this week for the DHS portion of that care, including a reduction in the need for the total single adult beds at ICE, which will hopefully give a more comprehensive picture of what we need and give an updated total.
Thank you. My time has expired. Thanks, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. And we'll have Senator Tillis, but I just want to, you've been involved in this for a long time, like myself. Isn't there generally a trade-off in a deal where one side gets something, the other side gets something?
That's how legislation
Hasn't
used to work here.
Has the trade-off been that we'll give a pathway to citizenship for non-felons in return for better border security, a modernized immigration system, e-verify so we don't do this every 20 years? Isn't that been the general construct?
So I'm not stating administration position.
No, I'm just saying
anything comprehensive. But that was where you had 68 votes in 13.
Well, I think if you go back there and look, you'll find a lot of votes. Senator Tillis.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, Mr. Secretary. Thank you for being here and for your patience. I want to go back to some number one. I want to start with Border Patrol. I think they're doing a fantastic job. I'm kind of curious recently, how's their morale in the face of all the things they're dealing with right now?
Their morale is impacted. They're tired. A lot of them have gotten sick. They've been exposed to flu, chickenpox, measles, mumps, all kinds of challenges in terms of the medical care. They're spending time waiting overnight in hospitals instead of patrolling the border. This is not the kind of work that they want to be doing, not what they're trained for, and it's an impact. There's no question. I think they're counting on us to have a conversation that helps solve this problem, and we need to do it.
How's recruiting going? How many open positions do we have now?
Our recruiting is actually proceeding pretty successfully this year. We ended last year with more agents than we started for the first time in 4 years. We've continued to make progress with our Border Patrol agents. Our CBP officer hiring is being dramatically successful. We've hired 5,000 officers in the last 5 years. We're gonna be over 1,200 net gain this fiscal year in CBP officers. So thanks to the Congress's support, we're adding key professionals that we need for security and for facilitating trade and travel.
The Border Patrol chief estimated that about 40% of the people are doing jobs that they didn't sign up for. You mentioned in certain sectors that's as many as 50%. When they're not doing Border Patrol tasks, what additional risk do we have in terms of illegal crossings?
It's heightened. There's no question. We know there are crossings that we're missing. We know that smugglers are using diversionary tactics.
Is it a diversionary tactic taking people that want to find a Border Patrol agent and present themselves? So you got all the resources on a group of people presenting themselves at the expense of drugs and human traffickers, using that diversion to cross the border illegally and just drift into the landscape?
Right. So we'll have a group of agents deployed in a certain area of the border. The smugglers will then, say in Rio Grande Valley or in Del Rio, send three or four or five rafts full of families across at the same time as they're making landing, and we got to make sure that's a safe process. Those agents are responding to apprehend, to support, to make sure that there's no immediate health needs. Meanwhile, people come around behind them.
And they're criminals, smugglers.
Absolutely. The same smuggling organization that's capitalizing on the migrants are the ones smuggling the drugs.
And you said, I want to get some of these numbers right. Number one, I want to make sure I got the right context, but you were saying that 9 out of 10, in response to one question, have a criminal record. Is that of the total of, give me an idea of what that means?
9 out of 10 with a criminal record is those interior apprehensions by ICE enforcement removal operations. So the 25% of their total in custody population that comes from interior operations, 9 out of 10 of those have a criminal record.
And you were saying that 30% of the people crossing the border illegally are evading capture. Why would they?
Are seeking to evade capture.
Seeking to evade capture.
Yes.
Why would they seek to evade capture?
Because they're
give me some examples.
One, they have a criminal record. Two, they're smuggling drugs. Three, they're a gang member. Or four, they're just a single adult who realizes that that's the one population that we can actually hold in detention pending an immigration proceeding and effectively repatriate.
Border deaths, something else we don't talk about, but I think in fiscal year 18, we had 281 people who recovered dead people on American soil. I think in this year, we're up to about 68 so far. Over the past 20 years, I think it was estimated somewhere around 10,000 people have died trying to cross the border on American soil. Do we have any data on the number of people who are dying on the journey before they even get here?
We don't have good data from Mexico. I think the Associated Press did an analysis that pegged it at least 1,000 a year dying in the journey in Mexico, and they acknowledged that they had serious information gaps that probably indicated they were undercounting. It's been a really deadly last 6 weeks at the border. We had a 10-month-old drown in Del Rio sector. We had two adults basically collapse almost immediately upon crossing in apprehension and were taken to the hospital and died in the last 3 weeks. This is the kind of situation that we're seeing, given the flow, given the illnesses, and given the rigors and dangers of the journey.
The public health crisis is something that we haven't talked about. You mentioned it in terms of the exposure that our Border Patrol agents are having, but what are we seeing in terms of the population, over 130,000 in the last month? What are we seeing about the general health of this population when they come into the country?
Well, we're currently managing over 250 cases of H1N1 flu in one sector in Rio Grande Valley, where we have an outbreak, and trying to do that safely and effectively. We've now have two pediatricians that we've deployed to the main station where these individuals are quarantined. That's just a snapshot. ICE has over 4,000 people in custody that are in quarantine for months. Meaning that the bed space in those locations have to be underutilized because they can't bring anyone in or out until that quarantine period expires. These are the daily challenges that we're facing, given this flow and given the fact that people are coming with more illnesses, and we have more children and younger children coming that have acute medical needs all too often.
Well, thank you for being here. And again, I thank all the people in Border Patrol for the work they're doing. We've got to provide them relief. We've got to stop talking past everybody and recognize there's a humanitarian crisis. There's a public health crisis. Congress's inaction is really aiding and abetting, I think, the increase in illicit drugs and illicit activities crossing our border. And we really do have to act. Thank you very much for being here and for
thank
your service.
You.
Senator Whitehouse.
Thank you. Echo Senator Tillis's remarks that we really do need to get together and help you solve the humanitarian aspects of this crisis. I do not think that a lot of the rhetoric that has been thrown at this issue has been helpful towards making that happen. Two things. One, you mentioned in your testimony that the largest group of individuals ever encountered crossing the border was entirely from Guatemala, Honduras, or El Salvador. What are the conditions in Guatemala, Honduras, or El Salvador that create that impetus?
Yeah, so I spent 4 days, a week and a half ago in Guatemala, and you know, meeting with the government, but also meeting with civil society organizations, NGOs that are working in regions of the country that are struggling, and with individual farmers
struggling
and
with
people
what?
Considering traveling. So the number one issue is poverty and lack of economic opportunity. That is the biggest and starkest reason for migration, really cited by everyone.
More than danger?
Talk to. Yeah, yes, actually, Guatemala is the least violent of the three, and all three countries have had significant reductions in the murder rate over the last 4 years. Poverty is the number one issue in Guatemala. Governance and control issues also, especially in the rural areas, are a factor. This is an area that suffered drought, and there's a band of called the Dry Corridor going from the northern part of El Salvador all the way through the western part of Guatemala, and they've had crop yields go down. They've had coffee prices tank due to the global market. They've had a lot of economic challenges that have exacerbated the situation. But the reason that I'm hearing, and I had a father come up to me and said, my daughter left with her child because we know that if she brings a child, it's a passport for migration, and now's the time to go to the U.S. So even though there are significant pull factors, economic, governance, and some security issues, what we're hearing is the reason to go now is the certainty that they'll be allowed to stay in the United States.
One of the ways in which you manage the population that is crossing our border is through for-profit facilities. Do you know how much of your network of facilities is for-profit versus not-for-profit or government-run?
You're talking about ICE detention facilities. I don't have that figure at the tip of my tongue here, no.
Is it a significant portion?
I imagine it is. I don't have that data.
Once you introduce a profit motive, it's a tale as old as time that profit motive can deflect behavior. And I'm wondering what you know as an organization about who are the owners and investors of those for-profit facilities and what conflicts of interest might be created by those owners and investors.
I'm not sure, Senator, the implication there, but I can tell you these procurements are overseen under the federal acquisition regulations. The standards are required to be met in all facilities.
Well, the implication is, let's just say that you hold children longer in for-profit detention facilities on a per diem basis, and at that point, that's more revenue to the investors, which gives them an interest in trying to support policies that maximize the time that children spend in their for-profit facilities. I think that's a pretty self-evident potential conflict of interest. The question is, are you monitoring that in any way? Are you looking out for that to try to make sure that this is being driven by policy in the best interest of the children and not by the financial well-being of investors in these for-profit facilities that you utilize?
So two key facts on the DHS side of this question. One, that we don't detain children in custody, right? We're talking about the central problem here is that we have to release families. If so, accompanied children are released very quickly. And secondly, unaccompanied children go to Health and Human Services, so they're not held by ICE. Two, release decisions are governmental. They're inherently governmental. No contractor can keep a child longer or an adult longer than ICE or another DHS entity says.
So they can sure push for policies that allow people to be kept longer.
That's a very interesting question. What I'm going...
Do you have any visibility into that question at all?
I can tell you where my suggestion that a better system would be to allow us to detain families together comes from. It comes from experience that approach worked in 2014 and 2015 under the prior administration, and a court order stopped it, and we've had an unbroken flow of increased families coming since then. And so we do recommend that we go back to that approach and get a fair and transparent hearing in an appropriate setting for families and have some integrity in the system. That's where my recommendation comes
from. As far
as
you know, there is nobody looking at the extent to which the owners or investors in these for-profit facilities may be having an influence on these determinations.
They're not influencing the Department of Homeland Security's determinations.
I would love that to be true, and I hope it is. Thank you.
I think, Senator Rauner, you have a question?
I have two relatively short ones. So I just want to, first of all, note that you didn't respond to my question whether the president had offered to pardon you if you went to jail for following his desired policy of blocking entry of asylum seekers to the United States, so the multiple news reports that the president made such an offer stands. I have a question relating to the provisions of this bill. Under this bill, you'll be able to hold families in detention for 4 months as opposed to 20 days. So that would mean that thousands of families will be in detention. Obviously, you're going to need more detention facilities to be built. But you can also consider alternatives to detention. So in December 2018, I asked you about the basis for your claim that alternatives to family detention, including the family case management program, do not work. You said you deferred to prior testimony provided by Immigration and Customs Enforcement, ICE, which did not provide evidence for this claim. Are you aware of the November 30, 2017 report by DHS's Office of Inspector General that found that participants of the family case management program, which you testified that in December 2018 didn't work, complied with ICE check-ins and appointments 99% of the time and attended court hearings 100% of the time? What fact-based evidence like this report do you have to support your claim that the family case management program does not work? If you have such a fact-based basis, can you cite me to them?
Yes, I'm happy to provide the analysis that ICE has of the initial implementation of the family case management program, the number of families that were in the system, their appearance rate, which was very high, and I acknowledged that earlier in testimony, but the actual results were limited. There were only about 15 repatriations at the end of that process, and now we have a situation where we have well over 100 final orders of removal that have not been fulfilled because those families have not come forward, even though they had access to counsel, social services, and a full due process.
So I think that that whole process, you know, of the case management program, et cetera, yes, I would like to see the actual report and the basis for ICE or whoever within the administration, whatever entity is saying that this doesn't work, because the indications are that it does work. So we're talking about a case management program that costs significantly less compared to detention per day for a family. So the figures I have is the case management program costs about $38 per day compared to nearly $320 per day for a family detention bed. And Congress sought to reinstate this program by appropriating funding for alternatives to detention for fiscal year 2019. What, if any, steps has DHS taken so far to reinstate the family case management program as Congress sought to fund?
Two important points. First, ICE is planning to appropriately apply the funding in the FY19 bill to try again on a family case management approach that would hopefully be more successful in getting results. But you mentioned that we'd have to detain thousands of families for long periods of time.
Well, under this bill, you'd be able to.
But that's not the intent. The past experience shows that we were able to complete these assessments in 40 to 50 days, get a result from an immigration judge, and effectuate it. And what happened as a result is when people saw they were being repatriated, they weren't just going to be released into the U.S. as a family.
Of course,
the crossings dropped dramatically and immediately.
You also are going to need a heck of a lot more immigration judges because you have a backlog of some 400,000 or whatever that number was for asylum seekers in the larger group of some 800,000 backlog cases. So you're going to need a lot more lawyers to do that. One would hope that you can speed the process, but I'm particularly interested in what you are testifying that DHS is taking steps to re-implement the family case management program. So I'd be very interested to know what that would consist of.
Okay. We'll be happy to follow up with the committee.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. We'll leave the record open for any insertions or written questions over the appropriate period of time. I just end with this. It's been a very instructive hearing. I hope the President will nominate you to be DHS Secretary in a permanent fashion. I cannot think of anybody I've ever met that's more capable of doing the job under difficult circumstances. We will try our best as this committee to get a result that will take some of the pressure off the people in the field. And as to those people, I apologize that it's this bad and Congress just can't get our act together. I appreciate what Mexico has done and will do, but that's no substitute for our own country changing our laws and trying to find a deal. Thank you very much.